I'm too young!
I'm in charge now.
Patrick,
hey!
That's a lighter. Do something.
I am.
Everybody in the conference room, let's go!
Huh?
Conference room! You guys can't leave this room.
This is your
on account
cell,
of
right?
your fame.
Well, yeah. I mean, as soon as we step out that door, we're just mobbed.
Just bitches.
Yeah, everywhere. Yeah. As far as the eye can see.
You guys are in this bigger venue now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And we've heard for the past couple years that the key to running a convention like this is miles and miles of curtain. So I was wondering, how much more curtain do you have this year than
oh,
last
this,
year?
Are you talking about square footage?
Yardage.
Or metafoots.
Well, we're in the curtain business now.
Oh, wonderful.
So there's a lot of lingo that you might not be familiar
yeah.
with.
Yeah,
synergy.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
But so you've been to exhibition,
it's vertical.
Right?
It's a vertical solution.
That's a lot of curtain up there.
It's true. And we found something like 1,000 square feet of black curtain, but
it's velvet.
It's velvet. Behind this curtain, there's some sort of dimensional portal.
Into the army.
Come take a look. How do you guys feel about, you know, convincing everyone to come out to your awesome show this weekend, which is going to be totally kick-ass, instead of doing what everyone really wants to do, which is stay home and play Bioshock?
Bioshock?
Yeah.
Right.
Well, they can play Bioshock down in console free play.
Oh, nice.
They really need to get their Bioshock on.
Bioshock is running in Microsoft's booth as well.
Yeah. No reason you can't do both.
Yeah, exactly. Don't choose.
You finished it.
Well, that's cheating.
Really?
No spoilers.
I won't. Yeah. It's great, you guys. It's so good.
No,
oh my god.
I hit the first twist. No spoilers.
Okay.
Wait, there's a twist.
It changed my life.
You know, I'm a petty arcade fan, but I'm really getting excited about the game now, you know, because it's an adventure game.
Exactly. You can actually go up and see it.
Yeah.
Now. That's part of the sort of like the kiosk demo is the character creator.
Oh right.
And then you see how characters that you create are spliced into the 2D.
The cartoons.
Which is maybe the coolest thing ever.
Yeah, I mean, it took
really hard.
It took a lot. Like, I think there were a couple times where they were like, you know what? Do we really need, like, is it a super big deal?
And
but like, now when you see it, it's like magic. Like, you create the 3D character, you know, in the Penny Arcade style, and then the 2D cartoon cutscene starts with Gabe and Tycho and this guy that you made, or girl. Mm-hmm. It's up to you.
I know some developers who are very excited to see your game.
Oh, I'll bet.
I bet a lot of people are excited to see it. Excited to see it.
So is there nervousness there?
Well, yeah, there's nervousness. I mean, it is our expectation whenever we start an endeavor to fail.
Yeah.
We
didn't expect anyone to come to PAX the first year. Like, I mean,
or visit the site.
Yeah.
Or, you know.
I'm sure that we will get laid into by plenty of people when the game comes out. But, I mean, plenty of people don't like the comic either, so.
That's true.
We're hoping that enough people like it that we can make more. And
I mean, I think that, I mean, I am close to it. But I think that there's definitely something there to like, and there's certainly nothing that that does what it does exactly. It's sort of a weird combination of adventure and sort of RPG combat. Like, it's not, I mean, it's not going to change the world, but that is definitely not our intention to change the world.
Like, yeah, I mean,
it's not a statement of, it is not, like, unlike our editorial content,
right.
Our game is not a statement about the state of the industry.
Right.
Like, our game is not an indictment. It is.
It's just a funny story.
It's just a goofy story that sort of takes a silly take on Lovecraft, sort of dark fantasy in a modern setting, and I mean that's basically what we intended to do, and thus far it's working out. So.
It's a story-driven RPG turn-based combat adventure game that draws inspiration from the classics.
Exactly, and it's episodic.
But how does that change the development of the game, and where is it going to go ultimately?
Well, it's really interesting, actually, because we've never made episodic games before. There's a lot of good reasons to do episodic. One of them, we get the game out sooner to people, and then we're sure with the Penny Arcade audience and the Penny Arcade fans, we're going to hear a lot of feedback, and we're able to take that feedback and incorporate it into episode 2 and the future episodes beyond that.
So if we hate it, you're going to just trash it and start the game over?
Well, probably won't start from scratch, but we're definitely going to be listening to what people have to say.
Have the Hophead guys proved to be able partners in this?
Oh, they're great. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure that...
I don't know if we've been excellent partners
to
them.
Yeah, I think we've been much worse to them. Like, I imagine that they would have much rather just licensed Penny Arcade and gone and made a game, and then when they were done said, hey, do you like this? Games look really, really bad until they look good.
Yeah.
Like, there's some sort of switch. Like, they would bring the builds in and we would stare at each other. We're like,
in
oh,
horror.
Shit. All it is gray blocks, man. No one's gonna want to play this shit. I drew a bunch of art. Where is it?
Where it at?
I had colors. I know I had colors in there.
A texture. Come on.
Yeah. So, but now it looks cool. So we're excited.
To believe so much in what you're doing that you can watch it, sort of like exist in this twilight state for months.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you know, in the last few months, it starts to creep up on something that looks like what you imagined it would. I mean, we make a comic in the space of 4 or 5 hours writing and drawing it, and then our vision is executed exactly the way we want it to do. Like, our level of satisfaction per comic, very high.
The comic comes out Wednesday. People say, oh, that comic was shit. We're like, okay, well, we got another one coming out Friday.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You make a game, you worked on it for 3 years, 4 years, and now you understand why these developers get so pissed. Like, when people don't like their game, it's like, well, that was all I fucking did for the last 5 years.
Yep.
So, leave the fight, start running again. I'll be followed, pursued by, chased by all those guards. Again, free running elements, level design. Now AI is chasing me. Well, people were pretty dumb during the crusade.
So I think that your demo here was kind of a success.
Kind of.
Yeah. There was quite a bit of cheering and so forth.
It's a really unique occasion to meet the people who are going to play the game. You know, It was like I talked after with some fan of Sands of Time, Prince of Persia, and it's like, and I told them, it's, you know, we're doing our stuff in our office all alone, and then we're giving it to you, and you play all alone, and we never have really the chance to meet. You know, it's not like doing a stage play where the public is in front of you. So for me, it's really, really interesting to meet the people who are really the core of the entire industry.
Who saw this demo before on the web? Okay, some of you, great. So I won't be doing it. I'll be doing something different. All right. This 3 minarets, just a tower. There's one over here. There's one over there. And one on the back. Which one do you want me to go?
The first year, wasn't it Dan?
Oh yeah, Shu.
Yeah, we were like, Shu, you should really come out, because we had met him a couple years before. We're like, you should really come out. Like, I think we're
gonna do something really cool,
really
here.
Interesting here. And he's like, listen, I go to LAN parties.
Right? Yeah, that's what he said. I go to LAN parties. Okay. No, I'm not gonna twist your arm.
Yeah.
Oh Shu.
But we've got Shane Bettenhausen from EGM. So you've got an EGMer here.
Cool. Yes.
He's not here to cover the show.
No.
Yeah. They didn't see the need.
Pure attendee.
Yeah. Well, yeah. No, he's here for the One Up Yours live.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, where they sit around and talk and yell at each other.
See, would you look at all these people?
I know.
Look at all these people.
Look at all these people.
Hey, I think it's
are they here by mistake?
You're not nervous.
Are they here by mistake? Is it an accident? Do they know what they're here to see?
They're all here to see me.
At least now they're person.
Shane, I'm just saying, you better be entertaining.
Luke's here, so I don't have to be.
Yeah, that is a beautiful shirt, Garnet. That's not just a beautiful shirt, that is actually the one shirt. The shirt to rule all shirts.
So what are some of the things I'm going to absolutely need to go see?
As soon as I have time, I'm going right to Eye of Judgment.
You want to play, what is this, 5-card stud?
No, man. Blackjack.
Blackjack?
Blackjack.
It's the Eye of Judgment, guys. Camera's gonna read it and it's gonna instantly summon the creature to the board.
Rise from your grave. Nice.
That's what, son. Feel quick, motherfucker.
Damn. It's so futuristic. I just can't handle it. Wow.
Oh, now they're gonna fight.
Come on, skeletons. They just stand there? My guys just stand there? Take it? Oh, that's what I thought. Good job, guys. Yeah.
Wow, that totally didn't hurt at all.
I think, isn't this card awesome? Like, shouldn't I place that in the middle?
If you had enough mana, it would be a great call. He's trying to cheat. I'm so glad the game won't actually let Ryan play the way he normally plays.
Really bad.
So is that an in the turn?
Well,
he's got 2 mana. Let's see if there's anything in his hand.
Right. I could play.
He hasn't got shit. To be honest with you, this is the perfect arbitrator. You can't cheat. The PS3's gonna know. Now this game's gotten interesting.
Because I am winning. That's when it gets interesting.
Matt just knows how important it is to let Ryan win.
I'm gonna, you know...
It's not good.
I think this is kind of overkill to use, like, such a strong dragon creature to take out, like, 3 characters that are completely facing the wrong direction, but... Sorry, Matt. <You're> dead. Do it. Kill.
But we now have 5 creatures on the board. And yay, Ryan! It'll be a better day. He gets like a mean alcoholic when he loses.
Yeah.
Well done.
So aside from this one.
Anyway, yeah, yeah, yeah. So Eye of Judgment is one thing.
So the Eye of Judgment Expo, and then after I see that.
Obviously, the Rock Band build here might have tracks you haven't played.
Oh, really?
Odds are good. I think that's 20 tracks on it.
I feel like that's going to be the most trafficked game at the show.
Oh, it will.
You guys are at the end of the line for Rock Band, right? You know this is the Rock Band line. How long are you willing to wait at this point?
Forever.
So how much are you willing to pay?
As much money as I have.
I might go crazy. I might go a little crazy with this song.
Get your business, see it, hear it, stay. If you can't, then it doesn't matter anyway. You will never understand it because it happens too fast. And it feels so good, it's like walking on land. It's so cool, so hip, it's alright. It's so groovy, shit's out of sight. You can touch it, smell it, taste it so sweet. But it makes no difference because it knocks you off your feet. So!
The concert.
Oh, I love the concert.
The rock and roll music.
We have freeze pop.
The final round of the Omegathon.
That's what I'm hearing.
I have heard that there's this game, what's the name of it?
You know what to say.
Angel 3?
Don't say anything.
Something to do with...
You need to stop talking.
What? A Halos, maybe? Pass. Halo 3? I heard this. I heard it on the internet. What?
This is the way the world ends.
Square formation and cover the right flank, over. Run.
his foot's inside the other foot too. I mean, that's the thing we disregard here. I mean, he's stepping on like the top of his foot.
You guys, shit, like it's going crazy around here.
When?
Down at the other end of the building, they're fucking losing their shit. One up. You guys are fine.
Check this shit out.
Yeah, but
which of these
the
dudes?
The world
which
is ending.
This dude is in the foreground.
No, John Davison left. And like, one-ups lost their shit. Have you guys not
I'm not trying to hear
heard?
About that. Check this out. Look, this dude's foot isn't even on the ground, and yet it's somehow overlapping this boot. Like, look, check this out. Which would be like, he's
here,
like this.
Check it out.
Yeah, we got this tag team-ish. And then check my foot. Why would you fire from that position?
Hold on. Kathleen, wait up.
So,
what do you think?
Well, it's weird. It doesn't feel the same as playing Metroid Prime 1 and 2. I think part of that, it isn't the holiday season, and those games are both holiday games. And, you know, when I was playing those games, I would constantly think to myself, wow, this is among the best looking game I've ever seen. Like, it's beautiful, stunning, and like, while playing this, that thought rarely crosses my mind.
So, like, I've gone up and down with this game. So, when I first turned it on, you know, you hear the music, the opening music, and like, I just got goosebumps.
The music is great as usual. I mean, same composer, this series always had good music. It doesn't look good. It looks fine. And like, it doesn't bother me. And at times it's beautifully done. But like, when those cutscenes happen, like whenever there's a cutscene where they show something really big happening, or they zoom out to show like something hitting a planet, or when you're flying through space, those look bad.
Okay.
Those really look bad.
Agreed. And anytime you see a person's face or the purple girl, like you're like, oh my god, that looks terrible. But I disagree. Like later on, the game actually does look good. Like I was like, wow, I just like, it's the same old feeling that I got in the other Metroid Primes where I just stop and like I look around and I'm like so intricate, so like,
to, like the boss,
the artistry.
Like the boss chambers are always really beautiful. When you're walking up, there's like, you know, a way to walk up, and it's just like, it's there to look pretty and like good color usage, good lighting, but still, like, it's dealing with the limitations of the console.
Well, you start off in these spaceships and they're all austere, just like sheet metal, you know, kind of boring. It's technological.
It looks like Halo, but not as good as Halo.
But as the game wears on, it's almost like they took the most boring looking areas and front loaded them. As the game goes on, I just slowly got more and more into it and slowly started noticing things. And like Skytown, which is the, like, there's several different planets in the game. Like, if you just look around, it gets more and more intricate, more and more detailed, just like the level of attention in art direction. It's just unbelievable. Right. Like, if you look, like, there's like murals on the floor, and like,
I agree that level in particular does look really good. I mean, like, the artistry, the, you know, the aesthetics there. However, like, still the graphics themselves, like, you know, what's on the screen versus how good I think these games used to look. It just it looks old. It looks like an old game. I mean, it looks like a really beautiful old game, like among the best looking of on the console.
Right. My roller coaster ride with this game has been hearing the opening music, seeing it, just like goosebumps, super excited, then starting to play it, and not only like the graphics are a little dull at first, but like the control, like I started off with the standard speed control, and I'm just like, you're turning, and it's like, okay, I'm gonna turn left, like take a drink, like slowly, okay, you know, like look around, read a magazine, like then you're turned around. And I was like jumping around, trying to get around. I wanted to plug in a GameCube controller again. Yeah, I was like, I wonder if it would take a GameCube controller. I wonder if I could do it.
I find that surprising. I started with advanced controls because I knew I wanted that control. I knew I didn't want to mess around with the other stuff. So,
so you did advanced controls.
Yeah, I started from the outset with advanced controls, but there still is like an hour or two of like, this doesn't feel quite right. Like,
you're lucky that you started with advanced because there is that learning curve, but you have to go to advanced because the speed is much faster and it's harder to do when you're aiming at things, but it makes turning around and getting around so much better. And it was immediate relief. I mean, I was like, oh, this is how the game is meant to be played. I came in, I was just like bitching to Ryan. I was like, I don't know about this game, man. I think they screwed it up. I just want the old controls. But once you get them down, the old Metroid Prime games, I think what their weakness was is once you locked onto something, you just shot. There was no aiming.
Well, yeah.
And you can, that option exists in this game.
On the easy controls?
You turn auto lock on. And that option exists in this game. But the cool thing about this game is, even though you can lock your perspective, and that's necessary to lock your perspective, it still takes some skill in how you aim.
One of my problems is I think that combat is actually more fun, and I think that makes the game seem more action-packed. It makes it seem like you're not just jumping around and locking onto things, but enemies take so many shots. They really do. And powered up shots are almost useless because enemies are so fast, they're always dodging them. So for the first like 5 hours, I kept thinking I'd missed a gun. I'm like, how come every enemy takes like 20 shots?
You do get this kind of super gun, which the game expects you to use a lot. And when you turn that gun on, it is much more like the old enemies, but you're right. A lot of times, like—
Are you talking about the gun that I already have? Like—
Yeah, the hold down plus the PED suit where you shoot phase on at.
Oh, things. That?
Yeah.
That's like a power up thing. I'm talking about like the regular gameplay against regular enemies in this game.
But that's what I'm saying. They want you to use that suit against the regular enemies.
Right, but that suit uses an energy tank every time you use it.
No.
I mean, it
well,
you drop it, in, you
back,
right.
It costs health to
you
use
have
that.
To be careful with it,
right. That's true.
I think the pure combat in this game is good, and it's better than Metroid Prime 1 and 2, but although it tries to be a first-person shooter, it doesn't really succeed. Partially because the AI isn't there. Like, the average guy you're fighting, the average space pirate, really doesn't have much AI. And you don't really feel like you're fighting someone who's living and thinking. You just kind of stand there shooting the head a bunch. Like,
well,
really.
That's sort of true, but they're better about dodging in this one. They also have armor sometimes where you have to blow off their armor with the missile.
They don't follow you. Like, I don't know. Like,
but Metroid, like, combat is an aspect, but really most of it is exploration. Right. And it's like just, and on that respect, this game is definite improvement from 2, like huge, big time. There is still the backtracking, but it makes the backtracking feel like it's for a purpose. It feels like you're really, like, it feels like the scale is huge.
But I think much like Metroid Prime 2 Echoes, the level design is a little all over the place here. And like really high highs, some low lows, like, you know, like one level I'll love, the next level I'll be like, I wish this was over.
I will say, you know, it's really hard to keep track of your map. Like you have to use the map, and in some places I zoom in on the map and I'm like, oh god, I'm even zoomed all the way in and it's hard to tell like how the hell I get through this.
Yeah, they didn't change the map at all. The map is the same as always been.
Right. But the rooms are clumped together and they're compact, and once you learn your way through it, you feel good, but there are some rooms that are better than others. So the scanning is back, and I started off scanning everything, and it's kind of one of those things where it's like, it's like a completionist thing. I do it, but kind of despite myself.
So much. I think there's more scanning.
Yeah.
I don't remember in Metroid Prime 1 and 2, like, individual doors, individual objects, being able to scan them before and after opening them with getting different readings. Like,
so one cool thing that they did though to make scanning worthwhile is you have these kind of achievements. I mean, it's not just scanning, but scanning, you earn achievements. If you do cool things, like if you kill enemies in a particular way.
So you
unlock these things, you get these achievements, and then you can use those to unlock like soundtrack songs, art galleries, and there's some cool like other options in there. And in the Wii Connect 24, you can even bequeath those like to your friends. Yeah, like your scrub friends. The scripted events, which is something this game has done much more than the others, adds a lot to it actually. And it's not just like always like watch cutscene, then fight, then end cutscene. That stuff still happens, but it's much more things actually happen while you're doing it. Things fall apart, levels shift and change. That's while you're running through them.
I feel like I've been kind of negative, but in reality, the game's real strong point is its level design in the way that it's like a Zelda game. Like, really, this is Zelda in space. Like, more so than ever. Like, playing this one, it's like, these are dungeons. They are dungeon puzzles. There's a treasure in each dungeon. And with that, then I can do something, I can have a new mobility through this level. And then I fight a very Zelda-style boss. And there's lots of bosses like Metroid Prime 2, and they're all very good. And the
bosses are excellent, and I will say, like, the new combat makes fighting the bosses, like, it feels crazy, because you really build up this skill to be able to you have to keep relocking onto things, and you have to be aiming, and you have to be thinking missiles or which viewfinder, and you have to be thinking about hyper mode.
I still don't like missiles. Like, I don't like the placement. I have trouble doing that. I don't know what's wrong with my thumb, but like, it's weird to me.
It doesn't feel more like a Zelda to me. It definitely feels like a Prime, and the way that it succeeded in it won me over, and it took me like 3 or 4 hours to start getting into it, and it's just getting better and better and better, and really like, peaks, it climaxes where it should at the end, is the atmosphere. Right. Like the feeling of being there, being able to be in an empty room, being able to be in an empty room, and maybe there's a puzzle, and the puzzles are quintessential Prime puzzles. They're not anything too tough. But like being in a room and just like wanting to look around and figure it out and explore and like look at every room is different, every room is unique. The feeling of being in this isolated world with the music and everything is really what's grabbed me.
I think we disagree there. Like, I think the graphics are okay. I think it's good for a Wii game. But like, in terms of being evocative and making me feel like I'm really there, no, it doesn't. Like Bioshock, like that makes me feel like I'm really there because the graphics look so good.
Right.
In this, like for me, the joy is the level design, the fighting the bosses. You know, that stuff's really cool. Like, I also love in this game that you get a lot of powers early on. Like in Metroid Prime 2, you didn't get a lot of the fun stuff until the very end. You didn't get a chance to use it. In this game, you get some of the better abilities early on, and they kind of assume you've already played Metroid Prime 1 and 2. I worry for people who are like new users who've never played Metroid Prime, they better play on easy, because this game,
it assumes
a lot of the player. It really does.
That's very true.
It's like, not an easy game.
I mean, I started off like this, I went down like this, and now I'm like, it made me a believer. Like, if it made me forget the Wii is piss poor graphically, which this game did. Right. Any game that can make me forget that I'm playing a game on the Wii, like on a glorified GameCube hardware, which this game has done, is unbelievable. Like, any game on a Wii that I can just sit there and like look in awe, like in actual awe at Wii graphics, it's completely art direction. This game is the best art directed game. I mean, those guys are complete but masters.
But in the same game, there's cutscenes where they pull out, I'm like, this could be Star Fox 64.
Agreed.
Like, seriously.
Agreed. They should never show human faces ever. They should never show human faces, agreed. But man, when you're like, just the amount of detail and the I mean, these guys are geniuses in artwork. Like, they need to have Retro be doing a lot more stuff. Yeah.
All right.
I like the I like the convention center a lot though. I think like the whole like layout is pretty good. It's like all like modern and stuff.
It's like a habit trail. You're walking through those circular hallways all the time.
Yeah, I know. I
felt like a hamster. Stuck in the press room pretty much all the time.
Thank you.
What did you guys see that was cool?
Well, for me, it was definitely Spore. But yeah, this was the first time that like the game was there. They basically said like, go nuts, like try, do whatever you want. And I started off by like kind of the cell form, so like, you know, you would basically
Pac-Man.
It's actually like more like Flow, actually. Right. So you're like crash land in the water, and then from there it's like very, very basic. You just have to like make your way up different levels till you get to the top of the ocean. But then I didn't make it out to land, and then like, you know, I'm still like kind of the fish creature moving my way on land, so I'm kind of like flopping a little bit. And then I went over to like this bush and ate some fruit. And then I had it.
No, this does not sound fun.
No, this is awesome. I mean, so I did make it to land, and I did kind of build up my creature some more, but I didn't even get to like the point where, you know, you get multiple creatures that you can control, and then ultimately, you know, build a city and stuff, and then eventually, like, even go into outer space. Like, there's so much more of the game that we didn't even see yet, but I mean, you know, I guess, I mean, it leaves me excited for more later.
What else was good? Well, Killzone, like, Hades.
Killzone, you guys tried.
Yeah, we got finally. Finally get to do the first hands-on with Killzone 2.
It
It feels like a really solid shooter.
You talked with the developers, right?
Yeah, we got to talk to them afterwards, and one of the more interesting things that came out of it was talking about the trailer that came out, and did that set some sort of like unrealistic expectation for themselves? Because, you know, it's pretty clear that it wasn't. And even they said it really wasn't their decision for them to be the showcase PS3 title, you know, 2 years before they were anywhere close to feature complete. And this, they pretty much said it created tons of anxiety within the company, because all of a sudden they had set this bar for themselves, and regardless of whether they felt internally they could hit it, they had to hit it. In a lot of ways, Killzone was like the de facto PS3 game that everyone was like pinning a lot of their hopes on for what the PS3 could do, and they had to hit that, or else, I mean, they would lose an incredible amount of credibility to Sony, to Guerrilla Games, and to the Killzone franchise.
So far, it looks great, but you know, we want to see what they're going to do with this whole weather system they've been teasing, but they haven't really explained about how the lightning works.
Yeah, so several times they hammered in how the weather is going to play a huge part in the game, and without really being indicative of what that means. And clearly they spent so much time on that 2-minute demo, making sure everything looks fucking incredible. You know, I want to see something else to know that the rest of the game is that up to par.
We did play Haze for a bit too, which was, you know, that one's actually coming out this year. From what we played so far, I mean, it was like definitely like the jungle part, the first part of the game was like really, really cool. It seemed like there was a lot of, you know, a lot going on in the environment. So it just looked cool, felt cool. But then once we got a little bit further, it was like, you know, this isn't all that impressive.
See, it
know?
Seemed more like it was less complete. Like,
yeah, that,
it wasn't
exactly.
Nearly as far as development, so why are they showing us this?
They had a couple other levels. Like, one was an inside urban environment, and the textures like weren't like non-existent. Like they looked like a low-grade PS2 game. They looked absolutely terrible.
It didn't even look close to PS2.
It looked absolutely terrible. But
yeah, and the driving part too, which was like, you know, the frame rate was like having issues and stuff too.
Just like you couldn't even control it. I don't know how the game is going to, either those levels are just poorly chosen, or I don't know how it's going to hit November.
The ladies are very, very nice, nice and hot.
Yeah. Oh,
really? Very, very hot, very, very hot.
So you can actually, like, Kojima is actually up on stage right now. They just showed the trailer. Oh shit, they're actually like giving away a ticket for like someone to win like a first chance to play the game before it actually comes out. I wonder how they're gonna pick.
Okay, also, wer nimmt sie mit? Look at the one with the sausage. Ideo, maybe tell us what's the story behind this.
It's probably because I love sausages.
The dude with the hot dog sign just won it. Kojima said it was because he likes hot dogs. He likes sausages.
But yeah, they did show the new trailer for MGS4. The beginning is the same, everything we've seen before, but at the end was all the four new bosses.
It's the beast!
No, but the whole like Beauty and the Beast thing is interesting. I mean, like he's basically saying that like all the bosses, I mean, all these, they're all like, they were beauties, but like, you know, the world has kind of turned them ugly and turned them into beasts and stuff like that. So, you know, it's all about, you know, can they turn back into their beauty? Isn't it funny? So, I mean, but you also saw, what was it, Borderlands?
Borderlands. It's like a Star Wars, Mad Max kind of outer planet. It's like this world sci-fi thing, and this is the Borderlands, or the edge of the world, this kind of like shitty planet that you're on, and everyone's kind of humans are in little camps, so, and the way that you can team up and move around is like Diablo, but it's not really an RPG, even though there are a lot of RPG aspects. It's mostly a shooter with all that kind of stuff on top, kind of like Crackdown in that sense.
Their whole like
tagline is there are over 500,000 weapons, which, you know, is kind of misleading, obviously, but I mean, basically, there's variations of any weapon you could want. So if you want, you know, a shotgun that feels like the shotgun in Halo, you can kind of get to that point to where all the variables match up and things. And
so
sometimes
how do they,
that'll
how
be
do
really
balance the game. Then?
Well, it's, like, if you're playing co-op or campaign, it doesn't need to be. Like right. they don't need. They, we asked them that question. They're like, yeah, we don't really care.
Yeah,
you know, they say if you come across like an Uber weapon, great. You know, go have fun with it. We're not going to stop you.
I would imagine the game must balance the stats based on.
I'm sure it will to a certain extent. I mean, they're creating this whole system that creates these weapons. They're not, but they're not creating every weapon by hand.
It's weird. It seems like a lot of the games we're talking about are shooters. I mean, that's just naturally what's popular. And one of the actually my favorite game of the show was they showed for the first time in game of Battlefield Bad Company. It's a lot like Red Faction. Volition, before they did Saints Row, made these first-person shooters that had something called Geomod technology. And basically, Geomod was you could destroy the environment, and you could blow holes through walls where there weren't doors. But it was one of these things that was fun, but it was limited. Yeah. Like at a certain point, the wall would stop letting you go through.
Right.
What Bad Company does is, with the new hardware, like there is no limitations, and it's not just like you shoot a cannon at a wall and then like the whole building topples like some games. This is like just the wall goes out and just the roof goes out, and so you literally can't hide. And what's cool is that in Red Faction it was mostly based on the player and what they were doing, but in Bad Company it's more the AI is coming after you, and they're throwing grenades, and they're shooting rockets through walls, and they're coming after you, so you can't hide behind anything. It's really, really fun, and the visuals need some time to get refined, but the core is there, and they've like I was kind of asking them, well, how do you figure in when someone, you know, blows the shit out of something and they can't progress further? Like, could you just like shoot the ground to the point that, you know, you get stuck or you blow up a bridge and there's no way to get across? And they said all the levels from the ground up are being made so that you can fuck up anything and there's always going to be a way to go forward.
You saw Midnight Club, right?
Midnight Club looks really cool. It's basically LA Rush if LA Rush was good.
Gameplay wise, we're seeing a lot of kind of, you know, open world stuff. It's much less of here's two or three ways to get around a track and more here's, you know, a city, here's the end point, get there. And graphics look really nice. And the most interesting part of that whole demo was that the Rockstar guy at the end basically saying this is the beginning of kind of like a whole world they're trying to create. And he was very vague, and like the way he was teasing it made it sound like there's this huge, huge thing that this is the first little part of, and they're going to create this whole world within like Rockstar development. So I don't know.
Yeah, and it looks great already. I mean, it's the same kind of stuff you'll probably see in GTA, although the graphics from what I've seen look better than what we see in GTA.
Actually, I know that they are sharing some code and stuff like that. You know, kind of all the experimentation they've done for Midnight Club, you know, that actually influenced the driving sequences in GTA. Rockstar also had the table tennis for Wii.
Table tennis for Wii.
I think realistically it's a good fit for Wii. I don't think it really impressed too many people at the show just because it was very simple. And we kind of know what to expect, and it meets the expectations and it works fine, but there's nothing really amazing or new about it.
You know, Wii in general at the show was kind of funny. It was like we went over to the Nintendo booth, but I was like amazed to see like, you know, 20, 30 people lined up to play Wii bowling. I guess that's the whole thing about, you know, the Leipzig Games Convention anyway. It's just like, yeah, it is. I mean, for a lot of people probably in Germany, they're like, hey, pay 15, 20 bucks or whatever, get in, and it's like a big arcade to them, you know?
So you guys guys, everything's kind of gone batshit crazy.
Yeah, fuck.
Well, everybody's like losing their shit because John's gone.
John's gone?
Yeah, John. He was our boss.
It's only
John
been one
Davison.
Day.
He left?
Yeah. Oh.
The English guy with the beard.
Yeah.
That's the guy.
Yeah, he was in charge and everybody's losing their shit. But you guys seem fine.
Yeah. Why is that?
Well, I'm sure you could take care of everything, right? Simon's in charge. Simon's in charge now, so that's good.
Okay,
good.
Father,
you did it, mate.
I got a massage coming up. I could be gone for an hour and a half at least.
I had my car waxed at 5. And then I'm at the club for 2 hours. Gym.
Someone will take care of things.
It's kind of awkward,
yeah, we'll
be honest,
okay.
Right now.
Just, hey guys, get that shit cleaned up. It'll be funny.
Fuck it.
Glad to be of help.